Good morning, everyone. Good morning, all you hardy, intrepid folk. Welcome back to the Peterson Institute for International Economics, aka Washington's Winter Wonderland. I'm Adam Posen, president of the Peterson Institute, and we're delighted, particularly for all of you watching online, to join us today. We're talking about the U.S. interest in international financial cooperation, and if I could, I'm just going to make a couple remarks on context and why we're doing this before we get to our extremely distinguished set of speakers today and the keynote by Nathan Sheets. As you know, there's an awful lot of stuff going on in Washington and an awful lot of change. And there are many old saws that are being challenged, some of which probably it's reasonable to do so, some of which less so. We view, as for all the diversity of views we have at the Peterson Institute, including on financial regulatory issues, we all view the benefits of having a rules-based system and having some international coordination as being, one would have hoped, self-evident, and unfortunately, in today's political environment, are not self-evident. And as with so many other issues today, this becomes an issue of at what point, how many body parts of the baby you want to save when you're throwing out the bathwater, which is a terrible image, so strike that from the record. You can see this is a live event, folks. Being a little less stupidly graphic, if we have complaints with what the FSB or what the US Treasury or the Federal Reserve have done in their terms of the cooperation with other governmental bodies and with the private sector, then we should fix those complaints within the context of the ongoing cooperative international system. We should not be opposed to the existence of international cooperation and the existence of international standards. Yet we have seen statements coming out of the US Congress, particularly the House Financial Services Committee, not directly from the Trump administration, but from people who are in the press recognized as close to the president and the administration, suggesting that international cooperation in financial sector, just as in other areas, is against US interests, or at least is suspicious. And our task today, therefore, is not to go into some high-minded, abstract, I can never pronounce the word, paean, encomium, praise to the glories of international cooperation in and of itself. Our goal today is to talk about what, in practical terms, international cooperation on financial, regulatory, and supervisory issues delivers for the US, and we don't mind delivering for the world as well. We don't view that as zero sum. And we have a number of both in-house and external experts with us today. Our first panel this morning is a practitioner's panel. We have Christine Cumming, who was first vice president of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York and a very distinguished figure in bank supervision for a long time now, professor at Rutgers University. We have Barbara Novick, vice chair of BlackRock, the world's largest asset manager, who is an active member of many international fora and represents BlackRock and her part of the industry in many discussions. And we have our friend and non-resident senior fellow, Patrick Honohan, former governor of the Central Bank of Ireland, who of course had to cope with what goes on when you have an international banking crisis that's not limited to your own country. And they will each be offering us their perspectives on both the state of current international standards and regulation, what potentially needs to be improved, but also presumably the ways in which it is valuable. We have a second panel, primarily from internal people, more analytic in work. And we have released Ted Truman's International Financial Cooperation Benefits the United States, a very timely policy brief ahead of the upcoming G20 meetings. On this panel, we will have Anna Gelpern, Ted Truman, Simon Johnson, and Nicholas Veron from the Institute, all taking different aspects of the financial, regulatory, cooperation and talking in real terms. What I kept saying to the team was, we're interested in financial cooperation, international cooperation, as the subject, not the direct object. So it's not, this is good because, it's what good does this do? And that will be the focus. But it's not all going to be hosannas. Again, there are critiques to be made. There are limitations to the process. There are realities to be recognized. And we will look at those. Finally, we will have a keynote address by the Honorable Nathan Sheets, who I'm delighted to have make his debut as a visiting fellow here at the Institute today. Many of you know Nathan, or certainly know of Nathan. Most recently was distinguished as the Undersecretary of the Treasury for the United States for International Affairs. He spent a long time at the Federal Reserve Board, ending up as the head of the Division of International Finance. In between, he was a leader at Citigroup as global head of international economics. Nathan is, to use a word that is a bad word today but should be a good word, an ideal technocrat. He is someone who tries to do the right thing and tries to serve his country on a basis of good analysis, and for that reason, we're delighted to have Nathan with us. And he will bring his own hard-won experience, which includes some wounds and disappointments from his work at the FSB and in the international process. Douglas Flint, the non-executive chairman of HSBC, who's a member of our Institute board, was also here to provide a compliment, was supposed to be here to provide a compliment to Barbara Novick from a banker's perspective. Due to the combination of travel issues and the fact that they just announced his successor in the press 48 hours ago, which was planned, by the way, Douglas is unable to be with us today. He will be coming back to the Institute at a date to be determined to give a global banker's perspective on this same issue. Anyway, thank you all very much for joining us. This is, my bad analogies aside, this is an important issue. This is one that should not be lost, even while we're talking about healthcare, even while we're talking about taxes. If we care about financial stability, and we should, you have to care about international financial cooperation. So let me turn over to my colleague, Dave Stockton, who will chair the first panel.
Thank you, Adam, and thank you to all of you who showed up this morning. My congratulations for doing so. And for those of you in your bathrobe and slippers watching from home, I think this is going to be a very lively morning. Adam's already provided introductions to our very distinguished panelists for the first session. So I think we just go ahead and get started. I think we'll have Christine Cumming first, and then we'll go to Patrick Honohan. We'll wrap up with Barbara Novick. So the floor is yours, Christine.
Let's see, I should have slides. Oh, there they are. Great. So it's really my pleasure to be here today. And what I'll do is provide some perspective on supervisory cooperation over, let's say, roughly the last 50 years. But I look forward to questions when we operate more as a panel. So, of course, the point is, ultimately, why do we need international supervisory cooperation? It is because the firms are global, the markets they operate are global as well. And even if it were the case that firms and markets weren't global, we might still have an interest in making sure that we were all working towards safe and sound financial institutions in our country, because as we all know, of course, most dramatically from the financial crisis, that the interaction of a recession and a financial crisis ends up being a tremendous burden on the economy with ramifications for all kinds of people, and that would include the international sector, that is international trade, which we saw clearly in the financial crisis. The problem for the international supervisory world really sprang to life in 1974 with the failure of the Herstatt Bank, which prompted supervisors around the world, but particularly in the then G10 countries, to think about what are the roles and responsibilities of supervisors of international, globally active financial institutions. And out of that thinking really came the what is today the Basel Committee on Banking Supervision, a forum where supervisors could get together, make rules, but also provide guidance and talk about how the world should be. And it's very interesting that the first action that that committee took was to establish the principle of consolidated supervision of financial institutions, something that even to this day, we still struggle with to some extent, what's really within the remit of the home supervisor, what's the role of the host supervisor, and how should the two of them interact. There was also a recognition that the safety of the overall system really depended not only on being able to deal with the crisis situation in a coordinated fashion, but also in making sure that banks really were safe and sound. This is a period in which competition in the global markets was really heating up, and one way to make yourself competitive was to not be very well capitalized. So there was a lot of concern about that, and that competition be something healthy, not something that would be destructive. And there was a recognition that there wasn't a lot of consistency. And this, again, is a continuing theme for the international regulatory committees to this day. I'll just posit five kind of tangible benefits of international supervisory cooperation for your consideration. One, and I think this is true of a lot of systems in the world, that you only know if it really works when there's a big problem. And so I put that at the top of the list. We need to be able to work together in those periods where a global financial institution or a whole set of institutions and markets are in trouble. Second is that it's really important that financial stability be resting on safe and sound financial practices across the major financial systems. We need to have a way to address new risks, innovative activities, and I think this is one of the real opportunities that the Basel Committee presented, was the opportunity for all involved to learn together about these new activities and come up with approaches to them. Of course, it's really important to keep the regulatory burden, at least manageable, and also to avoid a lot of redundancy, which, as I'll explain, is definitely a problem that's been created by the way the world's evolved. And finally, advancing supervisory practice and developing, I guess that's a little bit of a repeat. It's easy to forget that banking supervision as we know it today is really, the old way was the green eyeshade method. A lot of non-U.S. countries just use reporting as the way that they supervise institutions. And so there's been a tremendous amount of change over the last 50 years. And the premier thing for which the Basel Committee, and I use them as just an example of these kinds of organizations, IOSCO, et cetera, their premier contribution has been capital standards for banks. And it's easy to forget that capital standards, as equivalent to something like what we have today, really only started in the early 80s here in the United States, and the first international agreement was only in 1988. So we're still in the, what's early by many institutional standards. The Basel Committee's first principle, as I mentioned, was about consolidation, very still important issue. And another point I wanted to illustrate is that international supervisory cooperation is a living thing. It constantly changes, modifies, new learnings incorporated, and so we see that it both in this, this question of the division of responsibilities between home and host jurisdictions. We also see it in the core principles of effective banking supervision, which is, the basics, put on a piece of paper, which again is not an ancient document at this point, and continues to be revised and reconsidered. So what are two complications in the international supervisory world? Well, one that really upended a lot of the host-home relationships were the increasing centralization of key functions, credit decisions, risk management systems. If you went to look for the expert on many things, that person might be located in the home country or somewhere like London, if London was not the home where the experts were. And the host jurisdictions increasingly faced people who were not necessarily as deeply versed in how the actual decisions were made. They were more the front office people, and that created a problem for the host supervisors because it's much more difficult to know what the quality of decision making is, or what the what the strategy of the overall firm is, et cetera. Very difficult to know that if you're particularly in a small location. So for the largest firms, also the number of jurisdictions that they span also create a challenge because, again, how do you create a mechanism where there's good flow between home and host of information when there are, you know, in some cases, an enormous number of local jurisdictions? A second complication has been barriers to supervisory information sharing. And this is, you know, partly a matter of the privilege that's often extended to supervisory information. And therefore, the laws also talk about who it can be shared with, under what circumstances, and and under what rationale. And so, it's always been difficult in the past to share information with a foreign, or if you're a banking regulator, to share it with a foreign securities supervisor, in part because the law at one time just didn't really make that very easy. There wasn't a specific mention of other kinds of supervisors, and the same thing could be said of resolution authorities, et cetera. The securities laws also restrict, at least here in the U.S., the early disclosure of material non-public information that is prior to it being made public. And that has sometimes been a source of some strain because not everyone has the same securities laws. And so sometimes the U.S. can't be as forthcoming as it'd like to be because, in fact, it has to worry about this market thing on behalf of the firm. And then there's sort of evolved a principle in which host banks were expected to share a lot with the home country supervisor, but it was really very unclear what the home country supervisor was going to share back. And of course, the people that, in a sense, were most hungry for information were, in fact, the host supervisors who have to worry about how the fate of institutions about which they end up with very partial knowledge. Another benefit of the interaction of supervisors is, of course, that they learn from each other, and it probably goes without saying that the supervisory practices has traditionally been more advanced in some countries than others, and so there's a real opportunity to bring all of us along the path. And so what I think we've seen over this 50-year period is the professionalization of examiners. I don't want to say the ones before 50 years ago weren't professional, but the professional attainments of examiners today, of course, are quite a bit beyond the early days of the green eye shade. There's also been workshops for examiners across, or you know, senior supervisors across the Basel Committee population. There were experiments with joint examinations where if, for example, the German financial authority was going to send examiners to look at German banks in New York, perhaps the examiners from the Fed would join them in that exercise. And so a lot of learning, a lot of exchange would occur that way. The Basel Committee was a place where supervisors could get together and help develop sound practice type papers. These are not rules, but rather more guidance. but again, very helpful to supervisors around the world and often to banks to be able to see, you know, what does sound practice look like in the eyes of the supervisors. And then we also have the development of supervisory colleges. Now, I lived long enough from the day where BCCI had a supervisory college, and nothing could be worse in the world than having multiple supervisors for one organization. But I think we've come a long way in terms of understanding what a good supervisory college is and how important it is that the major regulators of a particular large institution are actually talking to each other. So the financial crisis, I think, raised a number of problems. I just want to highlight three of them. The first one is that liquidity provision to host country operations became a big issue, and nowhere as much as here in the United States. We live in the world of dollar markets, and suddenly we're in a situation where there were many banks in the world who are short of dollars, some of them in good shape, you know, reasonably good shape, and some of them not in good shape. And so this question of what is the appropriate amount to lend to foreign institutions was in part resolved by the expansion of the foreign exchange swap arrangements with foreign central banks, where we could put more of the burden on making decisions about how much to lend on the central bank of the home country. But nonetheless, this was a tough situation because, again, it illustrated foreign banks operating in the U.S., how difficult it is to know how strong the parent is and how likely the parent is to be able to survive. Then I think another kind of missed opportunity of the crisis was that, you know, we really didn't know enough early enough about the true condition of financial institutions and of the industry as a whole. If you think about the SCAP, the stress test, or even something less elaborate than that, but simply gathering all of the major exposures of the banks, knowing that in 2007 or early 2008 would have been enormously helpful to understand just how big the hole was. But think of that at a global kind of global industry level. I think it was very difficult at that time to understand just how gigantic the problem of bad assets on bank balance sheets really was and how hard the hit was going to come to revenues and profits. That really required, I think, a systematic look. That would have been an opportunity for the supervisors to step in and you know, try to do more. Not that they did nothing, but try to do more to understand the global context of the problem. So a lot of information was based on trust. I remember clearly myself when we first saw really elevated bank funding rates in mid-2007, and then the ECB offering that, you know, was kind of like all offers accepted, and the enormous take-up there was. It was the first really big warning signal that liquidity was very tight, and it was natural to ask, you know, which banks might be in trouble. Is this a sign that banks are in trouble? And, you know, you really, there was no way to find out beyond, you know, hearing what other people, the various supervisors, thought was the case. And then finally, as I mentioned, just as the Herstatt failure revealed a lot of holes, of course, we had tremendous difficulties with dealing with institutions that were in danger of failing, and, you know, I would dare to say some of them probably have failed, but we just didn't have the mechanisms. And so I mentioned here mergers. I think here in the U.S. we probably reached the outer limit of what was possible to do with mergers. Fortis may not be an example that's familiar to everyone, but this was a shining example of supervisory cooperation between the Belgians and the Dutch. And, you know, basically it crumbled as that institution got in trouble, and each country took their piece and saved it, but they weren't really working together at this very tough time. So good signal of just how tough it is to keep that cooperation going in the tough times. And then, of course, we all know about Lehman. So developments since the crisis, Of course, there's been a supervisory agenda, a pretty substantial supervisory agenda, in particular in the areas of capital, liquidity, and then this too big to fail, resolution of too big to fail problems. And so the thing I was involved with before I left the Fed is resolution. So let me just talk a little bit about that to give you a sense of how much closer we are to practice together as supervisors internationally and the benefits of that, and as opposed to maybe earlier sound practice papers. So right immediately after the crisis in 2009, there was an effort that got going to really figure out what are we going to do about resolution. One product out of that was the key attributes of effective resolution that was published in 2011. But there was also at the same time a group put together to really look at crisis management is what they called it, but basically, you know, how do we deal with institutions as they get close to failure? And that particular group formed what are called crisis management groups, very small groups of the principal regulators for each G-SIFI, these designated very large global institutions, systemically important institutions. And that group, those individual groups had to break new ground in setting up MOUs because you had resolution authorities, you had securities regulators, you had banking regulators, and again, those former barriers had to be shattered. There was a, you know, conversations with the firm, with all of the relevant regulators there, kind of something pretty novel, multiple jurisdictions, including overseas jurisdictions, and talking about, you know, resolvability and tough topic. Most firms don't want to talk about how they could fail or that they might fail. Identifying and resolving problems. So this group really basically started the process of trying to develop resolution plans, which meant that it's like peeling an onion. You discover new things as you work through it. And so there was a sort of continuous stream of guidance that came out of this process. In particular, to name something that's, I'm sure, not the most popular thing ever done, this whole question of recapitalization ended up being the TLAC proposal that was recently put into regulation, which is really an additional debt that could be converted into equity at these firms. The resolution plans, I think, for the G-SIFIs are mostly all written. Every so often, the senior officials of the relevant supervisors need to sign off on a resolvability assessment, which kind of lists the problems. And the hope of all this is you have people working together on a continuous basis on these institutions so that if we come up to the point where a firm might need to fail, that everyone sort of knows what the starting point game plan is and understands what their role is, and that we will not, you know, end up with things sort of crumbling at the last minute. And then the last point I'd make on supervisory cooperation is, you know, trust but verify has become a much bigger part of the Basel Committee's approach to things, as well as a lot of reinforcement from the IMF and World Bank. So the basic point is that if you go to the BCBS website, you'll see they are doing reviews of countries, how they're putting Basel III in implementation into effect, et cetera, to really make sure that everyone's reasonably consistent. There are always national differences that have to be taken into account, but sometimes the national differences turn into, you know, giant warehouse doors where you can drive almost anything through. And so, again, the Basel Committee has been much more proactive with peer reviews to try and make sure that we're consistent. And, of course, they've also, for some time now, had a lot of outreach outside of the members, the 20 countries or so that are now members of the Basel Committee. So I hope this gives you a flavor of the where supervisory cooperation is. And I'm hoping if you go back to those first things at the beginning that I said, this is a living process. So, you know, you learn more over time. You have to make adjustments. And you have to build new kinds of bridges as you discover how the world has changed and how what it's going to take to make cooperation actually work. But at the same time, there are benefits in that our institutions are global and our largest institutions are global, and it's very difficult to deal with the problems they have if we're not all working together. And third, there is a lot to be gained from working together on new problems. When I think back to this resolution work, for example, a lot of insights from a lot of countries, because there's a wide array of issues in those institutions, there's an opportunity really to get a pretty good sense of what the problem set is and to be able to work towards, you know, what do we want to have happen here. Thank you very much for your attention.
U.S. interest in international financial cooperation. It's a big topic. Financial regulation is a complex and contested area. So if you'll permit me to focus primarily on just a couple of aspects of what we've seen over the past number of years, and these will definitely, as Adam has suggested, not all be entirely complementary of the process, but I think throwing some light on the U.S. role in particular. And I'd like to begin with the question of bank capital, and in particular the use of internal models for calculating risk weights, as was brought in Basel II. I encountered this problem in three different waves. First of all, about 15 years ago, as a World Bank person advising developing countries, the FSAP program and so forth. Problem there was that, of course, you had a standardized method for calculating capital weights, but it was only sophisticated international banks that would be allowed to use their internal models to calculate the appropriate risk weights. But it's not easy for a regulator in a developing country to resist the trend to using internal models, as distinct from the standardized weights, if there are subsidiaries of foreign-owned banks in the country and they're being allowed to use these because of the global situation, big international banks. So regulators were going to be pushed. We could see it even before it became effective. All around the world, countries were saying, yeah, we're going to go to Basel II and we're hoping that some of our best banks will build these models, models written by consultants with little data to support the calibrations. So already right there, we could see a problem working there in the World Bank. Now fast forward to a European perspective, and fast forward to September 2007, Northern Rock. Well, I don't need to tell you about Northern Rock, except one thing, that almost the last press release on Northern Rock's website, I think it's gone now, but Northern Rock's website before they collapsed was the great news that our internal models have been approved by the FSA and we're going to be able to use even less capital to back. So then the third wave, Ireland, and it's a little bit different to what you might expect. Okay, so obviously not only the Irish banks pre-crisis models, internal models, they did use internal models, but they were pretty poor when back tested, that's pretty obvious. But more subtly, when I looked into this and had to see what went wrong at a deeper level, I discovered that the very limited resources that were being deployed by the Irish authorities in that principles-based regulatory approach that had been adopted in Britain and also in Ireland, the resources, the human resources, were tied up and diverted into tooling up for the arrival of Basel II. So it's complicated. So the central bank and regulatory staff, they had to learn about these things, had to set up the systems, and they really weren't looking at what the banks were doing. They were looking at this complicated new system which they had to comply with. So they weren't doing what I think Christian called it the green eyeshade work, and I call it the gumshoe work, and I think gumshoe is a more appropriate metaphor today with the snow outside. Of kicking the tires, if that's not a mixing metaphors too much, kicking the tires of the actual loan underwriting, realistic quantitative assessment of the risks being taken. Well, they just weren't doing that as the record-breaking Irish property bubble expanded. Now, what's the relevance to the topic of our conference today? Well, I think we all know here the suspicion with which many US supervisors have treated the use of internal models, and indeed the whole idea of relying on risk-weighted back, not just internal models, but whole idea of risk-weighted capital. Now, some of that opposition comes across as a bit Luddite, but the substance substance of the objections, I think, are surely correct. Supervision should not align with bank perspectives. The interest of the supervisor and the bank decision makers do not coincide. But both bankers and supervisors fell for a vastly exaggerated belief in the precision and robustness of what were actually pretty crude risk management techniques. The risk management systems that were used in Basel II, they were good enough for some purposes, but not as good as would have been needed given the reliance that was put on them. They could have been useful as management information, but they were certainly not robust against being gamed, whether by rogue traders or rogue profit centers vis-a-vis bank management, or by risk-loving banks vis-a-vis the regulator. The best documented example of this goes back a few years, of the large-scale gaming is at this Swiss bank, UBS. And this was documented at the time. People were shocked. How could such a big bank lose so much money? We know how the various profit centers within UBS understood too well the design of the risk assessment models, and they were able to hedge precisely the identified risks which would trigger red flag. He said, "Whoops! If we do that, we'll trigger the red flag from the risk management people, so we will hedge that one." Now, there's another risk over there, but the risk management system does not capture that. But that risk could be substantial, and even existential, if you loaded onto it at a sufficient scale. Well, of course, loading at that scale hadn't been imagined in the development of the model, hadn't been experienced in backtesting of the historical sample, but it was used in real time on a huge scale, the huge scale made available through the availability of hedging instruments that were thus being turned into weapons of mass destruction. So this is like a strong version of Goodhart's law. And the point here is that the inclusion of the leverage ratio, beloved by US regulators, rightly beloved by US regulators in Basel III, it's a reflection of the compensensical approach which I think has characterized US supervision for decades, even if it has been interrupted from time to time by waves of ideological liberalization. I don't think the leverage ratio is itself any better than Basel I fixed rate weights capital ratio. And some of the holier-than-thou attitude of the US officials it has exaggerated its merits. For example, the exclusion of some of the large derivative portfolio of the US banks from the leverage ratio as measured here. But having a belt and braces approach, fixed weight, risk weight assets, leverage ratio, it reduces the potential for gaming. The combination, it's like a double grid, helps reduce the gaps and loopholes that either can permit. And it is the US that has ensured this against some surprisingly nationalistic opposition in the Basel Committee and its relatives, the FSB and the GHOS. The US has won this leverage battle repeatedly against a kind of massed phalanx of many different countries from Europe and other places represented on the Basel Committee. And it has gone some way towards protecting the whole world, including the US, from the weakening of capital regulation. It protects the US because of the inevitable blowback across the Atlantic and indeed the Pacific of banking crises in any major center. Now, I wonder, is it fully recognized how influential the US still is in these groupings? Counting the number of participants in the committees does not tell you much about who is influential. Let me double down on Charles Goodhart. I'll point you to his book on the history of the Basel Committee, in which he tells the story of how the first capital accord was achieved. The key discussion was not actually at a Basel Committee meeting at all. In fact, it was a secret discussion, and even the British and US representatives at the Basel Committee weren't aware of what was happening in the sideline.
It was at a UK-US démarche forged at a dinner in London in September 1986 when Paul Volcker proposed to Robin Lee Pemberton, he was then governor of the Bank of England, that they should agree on a parallel approach, separate but parallel, to upgrading bank capital standards. Within weeks, that bilateral understanding reached in London had developed into a joint US-UK agreement, which was then sprung on what had up to then been a stalled international dialogue of the Basel Committee. And it led quickly to the accord, effectively concluded by the end of 87, on risk-weighted capital requirements for internationally active banks. And these two countries, US and UK, have continued to be overweight in subsequent discussions. So it would be a huge mistake to think that it's terrible. We go to this country, we have 20-something members, depending on which grouping it is. We only have a small voice. No. And I think more generally than just leverage ratio and risk weights, US regulators have refused to concede to banks under its supervision. Sorry, that's not more generally. It's a different point. Even though you get an agreement, if it's not to the US's liking, they will not necessarily apply. They apply something tougher, as it suited the US regulators at the time. And they refused to concede to banks under their supervision some of the weakening which has been offered by, if you like, non-US machinations at Basel, thereby protecting the US financial system and showing the way in which Basel rules are not binding in a race to the bottom. I presume that this is the basis for the US GAO's office finding. They have found that three countries have the lowest compliance with all the Basel III rules. In other words, they may be tougher. They haven't adopted all the practices of Basel III. And the three countries with the having transferred Basel III into domestic legislation to the least extent are Argentina, Russia, and the US. So go figure. Let me move away from this to say something else about the Europe and the US. And propose to you a kind of proposition that absent the US and the contribution of the US regulators and US officials in these crisis period of the last 10 years, we would not have seen as much European progress in strengthening and improving the whole arrangements around bank supervision in Europe. The SSM, having the leverage ratio supplementing internal risk models, I've already talked about that. The stress testing, the resolution policy. And why is that? It's not here, it's a demonstration effect. The US was seen in Europe as a fast solver of the problem. Problems arose and the US managed to fix them, hey, pretty quickly. Make a huge amount of progress compared to what was happening in Europe. And because of that, the European policymakers were inclined to look at the US and say, well, we never thought of doing that, but we better do it now. Good example is stress testing. Stress testing was one of the important dimensions to the fast recovery of the US. Europe decided after seeing, well, that seems to have worked, 2 years later started talking stress testing. Neglected to pre-stuff the banks with capital. That was what's happened here. You stuff the banks with capital, then you stress them, and look what happens. They have enough capital, more or less. European didn't pre-stuff the banks with capital. So it took a while before the succession of stress tests started to get traction and started to get credibility in the market. But it's definitely a demonstration effect from the United States. And resolution too. At first, in Europe, 2009, 2010, 2011, the Geithner Doctrine prevailed. So this is a US influence. Not always, I think, good. Could talk about the Irish banks, but don't ask me about that at the moment. But later in 2012, there was a return to the classic US view on resolution. And the classic view was the old view. There are bonds, and the bonds, you know, you lose your money on a bank bond if you didn't invest in the right kind of. So bailing in bondholders, and that's very much the European regime now, restricting ability for bail-ins. This is the way US legislation went also, and and Geithner's Per Jakobsen lecture of last year, asking if US has enough tools for easy resolution, points to the fact that the US has gone down that route. Now, I don't want to give the impression that all regulation is good and the tougher, the better. I would err in that direction for capital, but I also believe that a lot of bank regulation is unlikely to be effective and maybe counterproductive in its complexity. Well, I was going to say some liquidity is an example. Let me just say liquidity is an example, and maybe some other time we'll talk about liquidity. So what? Yeah, that's why I'm sort of saying no. I'm not going to go through these interesting topics that I was going to say. Let me just conclude. Europe blamed the U.S. for creating the crisis with subprime and all that stuff, and it took a long time for many in Europe to realize the intrinsic weakness of their banking systems in Europe. The speed and decisiveness of U.S. policy reaction to the crisis has been vital in leading the way to safer, sounder global banking system. Absent the US, we would not have seen as much European progress. A risky international banking system is a threat not only to the home countries, but to the US. And by driving improved global regulatory practices, the US helps protect itself.
Good morning. First of all, let me thank you, Adam, for organizing this and inviting me. And given the alphabet soup of acronyms, I can't help but point out today is March 14th. We'll call it Pi Day at the Peterson Institute. So, not that kind of pie. Anyway, let's just start with a little show of hands. How many of you have worked at a bank, at a bank supervisor, at a central bank, or in some way bank-related, even if you say my academic research is bank? So for our television viewing audience, that's almost the whole room. Not quite. Maybe it's 80%. That's important, as we'll go. So as an asset manager, we value, actually, financial stability quite a lot. And we're very predisposed in favor of international standards. We have, at BlackRock, established a global business. Today, we are active in virtually all markets. We have clients in over 100 countries. We have over 70 offices in 30 countries. And you kind of get a sense of the global nature of the business. So, there we go. So before we discuss the merits of international cooperation, I think it's useful to define the universe and understand the structure that's in place today. So prior to the crisis, if you look back, there were international standard setters, as you've heard from the prior speakers, and a number of countries also held bilateral discussions. What's changed? The number of entities and the pace of their work has gone up dramatically. In 2009, the G20 created the Financial Stability Board, and it gave it a mission, a lofty goal: coordinate at the international level, develop and promote the implementation of effective regulatory, supervisory, and other financial sector policies, and address vulnerabilities affecting financial systems in the interest of global financial stability. All very terrific. Today, there are 15 global standard setting bodies just recognized by the Financial Stability Board. You've probably seen some of these acronyms. Each of them has its own structure and its own focus. However, what you'll find if you work with them is there's tremendous interaction between them. The system is extraordinarily complex, and it takes a while to understand and to navigate. So I'm going to put this in perspective by showing you just one of those 15 organizations' org chart. The plenary at the top is comprised of the principals of all the members. The plenary is the sole decision-making body of the FSB. The steering committee is a subset of the plenary, and the steering committee provides operational guidance between the meetings, carry forward the directions of the FSB, and plan for the next plenary meeting. The FSB membership includes the G20 countries, plus the IMF, the BIS, the OECD, the World Bank, the BCBS, and I could keep going, you get the idea. Most of the principals are governors of central banks, finance ministers, or heads of securities regulators. The secretariat at the top is extremely important. They staff all the meetings, they prepare the agendas, they handle the invitations, and they prepare all the materials for the meetings. The plenary also created several standing committees. Each of these has a specific focus of its own. Each one has one or more working groups, and the plenary created six regional consultative groups. And of course, keep in mind, the FSB is just one of those 15 organizations. The meetings move all around the world. You could see why it's a little tough to navigate and to keep track of what's going on. Many of you, given the show of hands at the beginning, are probably familiar with the various banking agreements known as the Basel Accords. For today's discussion, I'm going to focus on asset management because that's the world I live in. So although asset managers were not at the heart of the crisis, we found ourselves caught up in what I call the search for the next problem. The process began with a number of critical assumptions. First, everything was approached with a bank-centric lens, since many of the people involved came from a banking background. Second, everything outside of a bank in the financial services sector took on the pejorative label shadow banking, which continues to be the way all of asset management is talked about today. Go figure. Hypotheses based on outright bad data and misinterpretations of data became quite commonplace. And finally, problems experienced with money market funds, legitimate problems and important problems, were then extrapolated to all funds, even though the other funds were fundamentally different. So rather than starting with an educational approach, gathering information, we found ourselves confronted with what we called the first consultation in 2014. Needless to say, for people who were not involved in banking or in this world, it was quite a shock. Given the banking lens, the focus quickly turned to the largest firms and the largest funds. Let's set aside for the moment the domicile question. The key issue here is that, unlike banking, size is not the key determinant of risk in asset management. For those of you who followed the ensuing dialogue, you've probably heard things like asset managers pushed back. It always sounds like an argument, whereas I would describe it as a journey of us learning what bankers were interested in or banking supervisors were interested, and of them learning more about asset management. Simply put, if changes are not made to products and activities system-wide in asset management, while the assets might move around, the risk isn't reduced. Three consultations, big ones, and many meetings later, the FSB's recent 14 recommendations for asset management largely recognize this aspect. Not surprisingly, these recommendations are remarkably similar to the program undertaken by the SEC starting a couple of years ago, which coincidentally has jurisdiction over almost all of these firms and funds. You may argue, so we got to the right place. What's the problem? In addition to this work, asset managers are also participating in forums regarding CCPs, market liquidity, and other aspects of financial stability. And for better or worse, this is a world that most asset managers have never participated in. So it's a very different experience and a very important one to learn how to navigate. So there's the question of should we or shouldn't we? And as some people have mentioned, there's been a recent public exchange of letters between Representative Patrick McHenry, who is the vice chair of the House Financial Services Committee, and the Federal Reserve Chair, Janet Yellen. And it's created quite a stir, especially in Europe. I've just returned from a trip to London, where everyone I met, literally everyone I met, asked about the US intention to participate going forward in these bodies. So I'll say, well, there's a lot of rhetoric, about international bodies, we also need to really carefully weigh those trade-offs. What does it mean to participate? What does it mean to not participate? And ideally, we can find what I call the middle ground. Can we increase transparency and encourage dialogue with practitioners, so that we get the best of both? That's how I interpret the executive order signed in February. President Trump is not advocating withdrawal from international bodies, but rather thoughtful participation. Likewise, the language in the Choice Act does not repeal Dodd-Frank or prohibit participation in international bodies. It contemplates what I call a more inclusive and consultative process in the U.S. before committing to global standards. Again, some perspective might be helpful. Over the past 9 years, an enormous amount of new rules have been introduced in the US and Europe. Many of these reflect global standards, and many have created a more resilient financial system. This is good. We should all be very pleased with that. However, even the supervisory professionals at this point are having trouble keeping up with all the new rules and being able to implement and supervise the entities that they're responsible for overseeing. So Mr. Mori from the Japan FSA said it quite eloquently. There are 140 work streams, and this was back in 2015. I think there are more today. It makes it difficult just to keep up with all the working papers, conferences, and proposals. Now, Adam told me before this session that we shouldn't complain about too many papers, but there are a lot of them. And that's before counting the work of academics and think tanks like the Peterson Institute. The mountain of paper is high and growing. And Mr. Mori's 2015 speech was titled, "You Cannot See the Forest Through the Trees," for the trees. And he correctly noted that the machine was continuing to produce more rules without regard for the cumulative impact. Now, I chose Mr. Mori's words because he is a regulator, and I thought that would carry more weight. So, what do we recommend? First, everyone needs to recognize that global standards can be and should be mutually beneficial. They can create a level playing field. They can reduce regulatory arbitrage. Harmonization of data reporting can be a win-win for the firms who are creating it and for the supervisors who are trying to look at risk and observe what's going on in the market for monitoring purposes. But that's not where we are today. We have lots of different standards all over the world for the same measures. We also need to recognize that there's been a tsunami of regulation passed with what I consider minimal coordination across the groups. It's difficult to digest. It weighs on markets and flows. The Fed recently put out a report about the impact of Volcker on markets. And a cumulative impact assessment is probably warranted, would be a good idea. In addition, we need to change the paradigm. I almost think of it as a critical rethink of the organizational structure. There are just too many bodies, committees, work streams. It's hard to keep track of. It's extraordinarily complex to navigate. And I'm not trying to whine or complain, but it's really a little out of control in that regard. The lack of practitioner-type input doesn't mean that the regulators or supervisors are aligned with the companies, but having that input, I think, is extremely important, because without it, we end up with some very unworkable rules. So I would just end by saying, before we embark on a new set of policy initiatives, I think it would be good to step back, assess where we are, what's working, what's not working, determine maybe what should be rolled back or rationalized, and only then look for what are the outstanding gaps, and hopefully do so very collaboratively. Thank you very much.
Like the panelists, join me up here at the front.
Well, my thanks to the panelists for those very, very interesting perspectives on U.S. Interests and financial cooperation. Let me, before I open up to the audience, let me just start off with a question that has to do with the arguments one currently hears for and against international U.S. participation in international efforts on financial regulation. So those that often support U.S. involvement, you know, make the case that one of the benefits is it prevents this race to the bottom. The U.S. typically has higher standards. It forces other countries to adopt those standards, thus making the overall international financial situation more stable. Is that characterization largely correct? And does it all really work in one direction? That is, somehow the United States imposing its will on others, or does this process constrain or modify the behavior of U.S. financial institutions, financial regulation? And if so, does that do so in a fairly effective and balanced manner? Those that often oppose greater U.S. involvement often make the case that, you know, this is a process that's dominated by the Europeans, and somehow the United States has a lesser role. Patrick's already mentioned that sort of counting participants is not necessarily the appropriate metric, but one still hears that argument made. Or is this really better characterized, as my colleague Nicola Verone has noted, as a North Atlantic bias that includes the United States and Europe? How does one think about the ways in which international cooperation, either it's a U.S. imposing its will or others imposing their will on the United States? I'd be interested in hearing your perspective.
Sorry. I guess I wouldn't go with either of those extremes. I think there has been a very robust dialogue. If you look post-crisis, different regulators reacted differently in the asset management space. I think some took the lead in some areas versus other areas. If you look, for example, at money market funds, the U.S. actually completed and implemented their reforms before the Europeans. Whereas if you look at the work ESMA has done on non-money market funds, they have probably led. So what we've advocated for, not surprisingly from my remarks, is it would be good to have a broad toolkit available for fund managers globally and to try to rationalize that toolkit so that the same tools are available to all funds everywhere. And to also raise the bar industry-wide on things like liquidity risk management. So I think we can get to a good spot in that regard, but I wouldn't say it's all dominated by one or the other.
So does the U.S. always avoid a race to the bottom? Is it always the case? I think no. I think clearly in the 1990s, there was the U.S. was part of the push towards deregulation. Here. But I do think there's a sort of structural reason for the U.S. to tend to be on that side, on the resisting the race at the bottom. And that's to contrast it with the other countries around the table who are inclined to take a narrowly conceived view of the current interest of big players or political players in the national systems. So transitory, political. What is our problem now? We can't do that. Maybe sometime in the future we can do that, but it would cause problems for some of our big players. I think that is a constant, if it's not a refrain, it's an internal refrain that is influencing what other countries are doing. I think we'll see less of that with the SSM and the Common European Framework. That starts to take a wider continental type perspective. It'll take a while to get there. But in the U.S., has always had many banks with diverse problems. So even if you think, oh, well, it could be problems for banks, you always think, yeah, that might reduce the number of bank failures. And we always have bank failures in the U.S. So you understand that whole process. There's the continental scale of the approach. And there's the long history of bank supervision back to the 1930s. You don't have that in the other countries. Other countries was a club of bankers saying, one of our fellows is not doing a good job, and we'll have to improve his behavior. But in the U.S., you have this long history, and that is an advantage which will erode over time, but for the moment, I think it's definitely there.
I think there's a healthy tension, as Barbara and in his remarks, Patrick also talked about, and that's a good thing because it's important to have contrary points of view and try to work forward from those and figure out where the weak points are. But I like Patrick's point that in the U.S. we've always had bank failure, and we've had catastrophic bank failure in the 30s. I think most people will end up saying what happened in 08-09 was also catastrophic in its own way, although it's less obvious. I think the challenge is to imagine the Basel Committee and the agenda over the last 50 years without the United States. They're just between the UK and the US, these are probably two of the most active financial centers in the world, and you need that knowledge, you need that sense of where the direction is in the financial system in order to craft good, reasonably durable standards. And it's just difficult to imagine that we would have made the kind of progress that we've made without the contributions from the major financial centers. I think there are also countries that have a very different tradition. I think about Germany and Switzerland, despite all the problems they had during the financial crisis, but their own very traditional, highly conservative views about capital and the like. And I think that's been a healthy ingredient in the international discussion as well, that it's not simply the U.S. or the U.S. and the U.K., but there are others there that have, it's different, but have a real sense of, fundamentally capital regulations need to put enough capital to support the banking risks being taken by financial institutions. So I think the tension there is good. I think there definitely have been dark moments where, the temptation to succumb to let's get a compromise that'll be, workable might lead you down the wrong road. I think about the long discussion around mortgages and what the appropriate risk weight on mortgages was as a good example of that. But on the whole, I think, crucial that there's a U.S. participation, but also the benefits of really having a discussion that includes many different, philosophies, if you will. Let me just add, the emerging markets are now, the larger ones are now part of all these G20 related processes. And I think that's also a very healthy addition to the discussion. It's sometimes more on the margins of the meeting and not so much what people say directly in the meeting. But many of these countries are trying to build a stronger financial system, and they are, going up against things that many countries have already dealt with in the so-called advanced world, things like the role of corporate interests in the banking system, or how much control gets exerted by the political powers in the government and the like. But they often ask the kind of questions about why is it so that is really healthy for any process. Why do we think that's important? Why do we do it this way? And I think that's a very healthy addition to the discussion.
Thank you. I'll open the floor to questions at this point. We have a roaming mic up front for the tables near the front. There's a microphone at the back, so feel free to stand at the microphone, and I will get to you back there. Please identify yourself and your affiliation, and we would make a special request that you actually ask a question rather than make a speech. So if that could be possible, that would be wonderful. So go ahead. We want to go to the microphone there, Jason.
Jason Furman, senior fellow here at Peterson. And these are three questions for Barbara, and they're genuinely questions. The first is, could you help us understand you know, tangibly what it means for BlackRock and thus for our economy, you know, the complicated set of super things that you described as the first. The second is, to what degree are all these white papers churning through all these international bodies relevant for you as opposed to their guidance for U.S. regulators, and then it's U.S. regulators that you need to read, and in a sense, there's no more U.S. regulators than there ever used to be before there were all of these. And then the third question is there any respect in which all of this is good for BlackRock but bad for the economy as a whole because it creates a barrier to entry that you're smart enough to navigate but your competitors aren't?
Well, thank you, Jason. All three interesting and important questions. So let's start with what does it mean for the industry? And I think I have to give a little historical context. BlackRock is the largest asset manager in the world. We have roughly 14,000 employees worldwide. Now, if you compare that to any bank, we are a pipsqueak in terms of headcount. And that's important because when people think about public policy and they think about government relations, they're in their mind thinking legions of people at some bank. That's not the case in the asset management industry, and even our firm, who made the decision coming out of the crisis to establish for the first time ever a public policy group. I call it much less than a platoon. So we have a very, very small group of dedicated resources, and we have no history prior to the crisis of doing any public policy type engagement along the lines of what we do today. When you look around the rest of the industry, it's even less. So you may have a thought in your mind that's a very bank thought, but for the asset management industry, the wake-up call was literally this first consultation: who are these people, why are they interested in us, and why is my name on the list? Okay, because they had no engagement whatsoever. So that's the first thing. The second thing is the compliance costs are not insignificant. Now, if you believe that you're creating things that are making the system safer, you say compliance costs are worth it. But when you're creating the same information essentially 18 different ways because we can't even agree on harmonizing the data standards, I consider that questionable. And I think we have to rethink what it is we're trying to achieve, what's the best way to get there. I actually believe for regulators, harmonized data would be better because you can compare it across jurisdictions, you can aggregate it, you can look at it historically. When we have different standards, different definitions, we have essentially a Tower of Babel. We don't have anything that's useful academically or for a supervisor. And I think that's problematic. So we're spending an awful lot of money as an industry to comply with a tsunami of stuff. But when we're all done, we're not really sure it's worthwhile. And the evidence is the FSOC recently did a study. They wanted to see the use of leverage and derivatives in hedge funds. So they went to the data that's being collected by the SEC and the data being collected by the CFTC, and they discovered the data didn't match, and neither one was collecting the right data to be able to answer their questions. So that gives you a sense on a small scope just within the US, then magnify that to multiple jurisdictions. The second, the white papers. Honestly, I never thought at this point in my life and career I would be reading academic papers, but I'll give you a sense of just two examples of why they're important. So there's a bunch of papers that have to do with macroprudential regulation. If you read them, they are by all the different alphabet soup of entities. What you'll see is there's a group of people seriously recommending capital controls be applied to assets that are managed outside of institutions like the banks themselves. Wow. The implications for our capital markets are huge. Now, you might say, well, that's just a white paper. It's just a working paper. It's going nowhere. There's an awful lot of seminars going on in central bank-type settings all over the world, and we're participating, and we're contributing. We've written our own white papers to try to understand you know, what would be the implications, and make sure people are aware, because if we get involved at the very end, as you know from government service, it's too late, right? You've got to engage in the dialogue when people are having it, not when they've finished it. So the white papers are extremely important because they point to what are people thinking about next. And what is good about it? Well, I think the financial markets are safer. They are more resilient. I mean, we've certainly improved the resiliency of banks. And if you just look again, evidence is good. If you look at the number of major market-moving events that have happened in the last several years, you know, massive shifts in currency from the Swiss National Bank move, massive shifts in Japanese equities from the Japan pension fund decisions, massive changes from Brexit, from the U.S. election. We have so many different examples of serious market events, and yet you don't see banks stumbling. You certainly don't see any going out of business as a result of it. So we've done a lot of good things to stabilize the system, to make it more resilient. That doesn't mean there aren't winners and losers. Lots of people make money, lots of people lose money. You see sometimes, you know, some stunning stories about this hedge fund or that hedge fund or a family office. There's a lot of money changing hands, but it's not about banks failing or creating a systemic risk. So I don't think it's so much about the competitive barriers. I think it's really more about resilience is the most positive thing.
Ted Truman, I was holding back, but since this is prime from Peterson Institute, this is mostly Peterson, almost on a lot of, you got a higher proportion of Peterson people than the usual. So my question on the alphabet soup issue, which I think each of you could probably answer, is to what extent is the alphabet soup being driven by the fact that, in particular in this jurisdiction, we have an alphabet soup to start with, right? And the lack of, so what is the hope that you could actually solve Barbara's problem, if you want to put it that way, or ameliorate it somewhat by having some more, if you think that's good, by having some more consolidation in the supervisory structures rather than having a, essentially parallel structures for each of the so-called areas of business. Is that good or bad, or is that likely to happen?
If I could weigh in, and Christine, maybe you'll have some ideas as well. The U.S. system is absurdly complex, so it is a take care of the problem at home first, perhaps. It would be great to have the SEC and the CFTC as one, or at least working together where there are things like reporting standards. Sometimes you can't be one, but you can act as one on certain projects. We started to see that towards the end of the administration, but we did not see that earlier on. I think if we can go down that trajectory, that would be very, very helpful. Likewise, on the banking side, I'm not a banking specialist, and BlackRock's not a bank. In case you're wondering. So I'm not going to weigh in, but it seems to me like we could consolidate a few of those.
So I think that kind of go back to your alphabet soup, you know, there's one piece of hope on the list that you presented, and that is one of those organizations has disappeared. The joint forum no longer exists. So, you know, occasionally we get around to sunsetting some of these organizations. I'd also note that a lot of work is done that the CPMI does, which is the payment system people, that they do that in conjunction with IOSCO because there's a lot of overlap in the kinds of organizations, particularly these CCPs. So I think that's a very positive sign. If I took that list, I think we could triage it pretty effectively. There are organizations there like the CGFS, which, you know, really largely does studies. They don't really promulgate any kind of regulation or even what you call sound practice papers, that the bulk of what they do is looking at, you know, market and financial stability issues. so we could triage the list, and clearly at the top of the list is the FSB and the Basel Committee, because I would say what they do ends up having a lot of impact on others. And then you can turn to IOSCO, which, again, another, you know, very historically heavily U.S.-dominated organization. And then it sort of tapers off a bit. And when you look at a number of the more significant standard-setting organizations on that list, they really are organized by expertise. And the question is, can you toss it all together and have, you know, multiple expertise areas and still come up with, you know, high-quality standards? So I think that when you look at the bigger, true standard-setting bodies out of that list, it's not that many of them, really, and they are really organized around expertise that is, reasonably well-defined and hard to replicate. I'll say one more thing, though. I've seen a situation, for example, the CPMI. I'm not, you know, never been a member. But, you know, they are really struggling with the issue of how to handle the failure of a CCP. And that's a case where I think more constructive engagement with FSB-type people or the Basel Committee would be really useful, because they're having a hard time getting out of the box of these are the rules for how the CCP works, instead of thinking about, well, what is your objective in trying to manage the failure of a CCP? And clearly things like continuity of operations and a good transfer to better hands is a key part of what we've been trying to achieve more generally in resolution, and you know, is also enshrined in things like Chapter 11 in our own bankruptcy code. CPMI is the Committee on Payments and Market Infrastructure. So these are the guys that think about things, everything from Fedwire, and I hate to say it, SWIFT, and also things like the major CCPs in the world.
I just wanted to say I thought it was wonderful to have Barbara here, because she is at the point. Why is she complaining so much? Because this is the point which we're still in the process of saying, what is a shadow bank? We know shadow banks were somewhere in the shadows and cause a lot of this thing, but what is a shadow bank? Since they're not regulated, we better collect information on it. And I know in Dublin we had a lot of funds, so you collect information. What do you collect information, where will you find the information? Well, if they have a tax privilege, maybe we can get something from the tax authorities. Maybe we could do a survey. So I think all jurisdictions were in a fog. And that's still the situation, that you're collecting information from this person, for that person, the other person, and there is no systematic approach to it, because this is the area which was not regulated. And that's, you're in that process. You don't want it to be regulated, maybe, or you do want it regulated, but you'd like it regulated systematically. This is a process that's going to go on for some time, because still we don't know much about it. And I wouldn't call BlackRock a shadow bank, but it's very hard to say, well, they're not a shadow bank, because they're not regulated. Well, they are regulated to some extent.
So I think I get a rebuttal. By the way, I don't think I'm complaining. I'm simply trying to explain. We're not a shadow bank. The asset management industry is not a shadow bank. We definitely prefer the phrase market finance, which is different than bank finance. There were shadow banks. I'm sorry to say, they were things like off-balance sheet sieves of banks, not asset managers. To say asset managers are unregulated would be fairly shocking for our legal department, which has several hundred members who work with regulators around the world. We have a map which actually shows all the regulators we report to, another alphabet soup, so I won't go into that. But very important, in Christine's slide, she talked about the importance of local risk managers and local decision making, and that has promulgated through the securities regulators around the world. I think there's not a lot of understanding of the regulation that's in place. Now, on the other side of it, if somebody from a central bank turns to a securities regulator and says, you know, which funds use leverage, and they say, I don't know. Which funds use derivatives, and they say, I don't know. They say, well, can you tell me about, you know, whatever the X is, and they say, I don't know, clearly there's missing data and there's a data gap. So we're actually not against any of the data collection. We actually have spoken out quite favorably on the what we call the modernization of the rules. The problem we have is there's not one set of data. There's the same funds reporting the same data differently to multiple entities, even here within the United States. So we do need to clean this up. It isn't helpful to the regulators themselves. Forget whether it's good for us or not. It's actually data that's not very useful to a supervisor. So if you really want to say, well, I'd like to monitor the buildup of derivatives or leverage in the system, you have to have apples-to-apples information so that you can look across jurisdictions, and you can look historically, is it different than what's happening? How does the fund portion of the industry interact with other portions of the industry? But we keep focusing on funds, and I say to people, funds are maybe 20% of the investable assets. There's another 80%. We're not looking at that other 80% at all. That seems a little odd. So if we really want to understand system-wide risk and the interactions between the pieces, that makes a lot of sense to us. But if we're going to keep focusing on just one piece as if that's the whole, we're making a mistake. We'll get very bad information and make very bad decisions.
We have time for two more questions, and I have the vote back in the table here.
Hi, Lou Pauley, University of Toronto. I know the answer to the question is both, but looking back at history, Chris, whenever she got to the point where decisions were made, she mentioned particular people who had particular roles in particular institutions. So the question is, in the search for coordination and deeper collaboration, which we probably share in this room, should the leadership be taken by the fiscal authority or the monetary authority?
I suspect you need both. When I think about the role of the Treasury Secretary here in the United States, I think he is widely viewed as the senior most financial authority in the country. And that, again, when you think about the structure of the FSOC, it mirrors that in that the idea is to bring together as much of the regulatory community as possible in a council that's chaired by the Secretary of the Treasury. And when I think about financial reform proposals, they have generally come from the Office of the Secretary of the Treasury. So I think that, you know, that you do need the fiscal authorities in that sense. I do think the monetary authorities have a lot to add. They historically in this country have considered financial stability as part of their mandate, even though we now have this FSOC, which is also, you know, very much concerned with financial stability. So I think they both have a lot to offer, and I think that's something you'd find in most countries, is that the central bank and the finance ministry have a lot to offer. I think one group that also has a lot to offer that we haven't heard that much about since the crisis is the private sector. And I think that Barbara mentioned also how little consultation there seems to have been, informal consultation, I guess I'd call it, with the private sector. And I think that, you know, understandable at the time of the crisis and immediately after the, you know, difficulty of that dialogue, but I think it's been a huge hole, a huge gap in our ability to formulate good, better policies, and also to set objectives. I'm very sympathetic to Barbara's view that we should be working on better data. After all, the Dodd-Frank bill did include the OFR as a place to help us figure out how we can get better data.
If I could just add, Lou, you don't mind my saying, you didn't even mention market regulators as one of your choices. And I think that's the crux of the problem. It's not just about fiscal or monetary. There's a whole body of regulators whose expertise is securities markets. And they should be factored in as equal partners and in some ways as senior partners in this dialogue.
Nuri Rubini from New York University. My question is, how much you think that the new Trump administration is going to change his approach or views about international financial cooperation, and related to that, how much of potential proposed changes in Dodd-Frank may lead then to things that are consistent or inconsistent, what has been done at the international level?
Difficult question, which I hope everybody will at least offer a thought or two on.
Well, I'll be intrepid and start. I think there are parts of the important financial reforms since the crisis that can largely be untouched by Dodd-Frank, changes to Dodd-Frank, or repeal, whatever we end up with. And that's because the capital regulations, clearly within the authority of the existing banking regulators, and so we've basically translated that international agreement into U.S. regulation. I think that could be largely untouched. But there are other areas like resolution, which I think is an extremely important. We have a lot of forward progress there that's important not to lose. There are some challenges, I think, on the budget side, on the way it's scored. Currently, Title II of the Dodd-Frank Act. But it would be, I think, a tragedy if we ended up losing that. The stress tests, I'm not a lawyer. I don't know how much authority for the stress tests is actually in Dodd-Frank, but I think that's been a powerful tool. And so again, if you're doing a triage of what's most important out of the financial crisis, those are the things that I would particularly stress. As you know, it's a huge regulation. There's a lot of stuff in there, and there's definitely things that need to be fixed. And so, again, one could hope for a good orderly process to look at where we need changes. But I'd hope those core things did not vanish.
Complexity is counterproductive. This really desirable to have a huge simplification of streamlining and a greater reliance on simple things like more capital for prudential, and it's really prudential regulation I'm talking about, not so much about. And I think that I didn't in any way mean to minimize the problem here. This part of the simplification would be, yes, let's cut through the complexities of what all the other firms do and find better data from them. So a goal for simplification would be something that I think could receive bipartisan support from everybody, but not making things easier in the sense of less. I repeat, capital is a solution to many problems.
So I'm just going to read from the executive order. Again, it only has seven principles. One of them is enable American companies to be competitive with foreign firms in domestic and foreign markets. And two is advance American interests in international financial regulatory negotiations and meetings. I don't read those as let's secede from the process. I read those as let's engage in the process and be very serious about it. But let's also recognize that we want one set of standards that applies globally and doesn't disadvantage our companies versus others. And I think that should be a good guiding principle. When I read the Choice Act and the proposed language, it's about more transparency. It's about more engagement. It's about really getting the right expertise in the room. It's not about withdrawing from the process either. So I would say I would expect to continue to see the U.S. very engaged in these organizations and very interested in setting global standards. That's the optimist in me.
Thank me, and will you join me in thanking the panel in a really, I think, excellent conversation this morning. So.
Indeed. And thank you, David, for chairing so ably. It's great to have the practitioner's perspective. These are very thoughtful practitioners, and we're very grateful to Barbara, to Chris, to Patrick for doing this. We're going to take a very brief break and reconvene at 11:45 for our next panel, which Jason Furman will chair. Thank you very much.